This podcast is brought to you by the School of Advanced Study, University of London.
Years or so, the neuroscience of consciousness has regained a kind of central focus within the mind and brain sciences. And at Sussex, we have this dedicated research centre now, which mixes approaches across psychology, neuroscience, psychiatry, neurology, mathematics, and computer science. So we take a very multidisciplinary approach. What we don't have much in the centre itself is input from the humanities, and that's part of the motivation for this meeting and for our interaction with the Human Mind Project. Because understanding something, you know, as rich as conscious experience is not just the experience of seeing red, it's the rich experience of our entire human life, and that obviously needs the contribution. What are we trying to explain? Well, we need the humanities to help inform all of that. But at the Sackler Centre, we're more focused in translating understanding derived from the neuroscience of consciousness into its clinical application. So we study various clinical populations and try to share insights between the two approaches. Now, the Human Mind Project was launched in December 2013 in London, and the idea of that was to bring together leading experts from a variety of disciplines across the arts and the humanities, as well as the cognitive and social sciences, to discuss and document the present landscape of research on the mind, and making a coordinated international effort to define the major intellectual challenges in understanding the nature and significance of the human mind. That's the Human Mind Project. It's led by Sir Colin Blakemore, who will be joining us at some point. He's very rarely on time, so I understand. So this is not unexpected. And so he started the Human Mind Project, and now various other people across the multiple disciplines have joined it. Now, workshops are a very central aspect of the activity of the Human Mind Project, especially nicely focused, non-busy workshops like this one. And this is the eighth of the series. Previous workshops have focused on topics like language, literacy in the mind, collective intelligence, social change in the brain age, and I think the first one I went to was Computers and Mind in Edinburgh about 2 years ago, and one of our guests, Shannon Chandrini, were there, which for that one. Human Mind Project and various workshops that are going on. This is taken from the website of the Human Mind Project. This is a very nice thing to look at and to visit the website, as well as information about the workshops and the project. There's also a series of grand challenges, and this is the other central aspect of what the Human Mind Project is about, so to foster discussion about some of the big questions that intersect across all these disciplines. And one of the current grand challenges, rather grand, is to address the question, what is the human mind? So you can find out more about that on the website there. Which brings me to the topic of this afternoon and tomorrow morning, which is to discuss emotion, memory, and the mind. Now, why that focus? Well, it's interesting. When you study consciousness in the lab, it's very easy to think in terms of, as I said earlier, the experience of seeing red. We tend to focus quite a lot on how we become aware of things in the external world, because those things tend to be easier to manipulate in the lab. You can show people this picture, that picture, see what goes on in the brain, what doesn't go on in the brain. And that's very important and interesting, of course. But the conscious experience of being a self, of being the specific person that you are, is perhaps more central and more important when it comes to understanding consciousness in the round. And there, of course, memories and emotions are perhaps equally important, perhaps more important, in shaping our experience of being a self than our experiences of visual scenes or auditory inputs and so on. So if we're trying to understand the human mind and the experience of being a self, emotion and memory are really at the centre of that. And of course, emotion and memory provide very rich links to the humanities also. A lot of the humanities, a lot of creative humanities as well, is based on an understanding, developing an understanding of self through emotion and memory. So that's what we're going to be talking about the next this afternoon and tomorrow morning. What do we remember? How we remember it? How it constitutes the texture of human life? And how emotions play into this process as well. So we're very grateful to have some extraordinary speakers from across the sciences and the humanities here this afternoon and tomorrow morning. And Mattia will introduce them.
So a very warm welcome from me too. My name is Mattia Gallotti. I'm a research fellow in philosophy in the School of Advanced Study, University of London, where I also look after the Human Mind project. Anil has already said something about the project. I'm not going to add much more. Colin Blakeman tomorrow will share the final roundtable discussion on the future of research, this particular question, so I'm sure he will add something more about the project. I'm going to share the session today in the afternoon, the one on memory, and I'm very pleased and honored to introduce our wonderful speakers for today. Alright, so you probably have the program of the event with you. You will see that the session today is focused on memory. We'll have three speakers, starting with Nicola Clayton and Clive Wilkins, and followed by Catherine Loveday. You will see that there is no discussion in between, so I asked our speakers to give their talks without actually, we won't break for discussion between the first and the second talk. Then Anil will engage in a conversation with Nick Payne, and then we'll have a joint roundtable discussion on memory with all the speakers and Anil. Where if you have any questions about the talk, any questions in general, you could, that would be a nice time to address them. And the roundtable discussion will be late afternoon, possibly around 5:15, 5:30, for about half an hour, 45 minutes. Alright, so without further ado, I'm going to introduce Nicola Clayton and Clive Wilkins. I've known that for a while now, so Nicky Clayton is Professor of Comparative Cognition in the Department of Psychology at the University of Cambridge. And Clive Wilkins, artist and writer, is artist in residence in the Psychology Department at Cambridge. They have been collaborating for quite a long time now, and I think they will present some result of their collaboration today. Catherine Loveday is Principal Lecturer of Psychology at the University of Westminster. She has a long-standing interest in memory and aging. I'm not going to say much about their research, just because we asked our speakers to devote the first, say, 5-10 minutes of their talk to some overview of their field, what they think the key questions are. So that would be a nice occasion for them to introduce their own research. Alright, I think we can start now. Our first speakers are Nicky and Clive.
As scientists and artists respectively, we are interested in the constraints on our cognitive processes, and particularly within the areas of memory and perception, and how the two relate.
Yes, it's very easy for us to make the assumption that what we perceive and how we remember are accurate reflections of reality. And indeed, many of our greatest deceptions evolve out of such faulty supposition.
To allow us to show a short little clip, it'd be really interesting to know how many people have seen this before.
An event seen from one point of view gives one impression. Quite a different impression. But it's only when you get the whole picture you can fully understand what's going on.
show you another demonstration.
A piece of evidence, if you like.
Understanding of how the world works. Now, of course, these days,
it seems obvious that we alter our memories each time we revisit, depending on our mood and our point of view and our understanding of the self in the present. But it hasn't always been like that. For centuries, people just assumed that memory was an accurate repository of the past. The fact that we now know that we are capable of making our memories shimmer and change causes us to frequently question the authenticity of memory. What was real? What was imagined? And what, if any of it, will be real tomorrow? And in the following extract that Clive's going to read from his series of novels in Moustachio Quartet, we're going to explore how thoughts of the past and the future can be so easily transformed.
In the gloom, he had followed the lines of the streets with his thoughts and had eventually found himself at the tango by the river. The dancing was glorious, and he had lost himself to moments that opened up for him. The release, as ever, had been joyous. He felt he was outside of time. The spirit of the experience flashes before him. He observes it, remotely quantifying the sensations, checking and wondering if his observations still matched his earlier recollection. Even in this short time, Saviour recognised that his sense of recall, his remembrance, and his emotional responses had become altered in some way beyond his control. What had been missed or forgotten? What had altered?
So what all these evidences suggest is that despite our desire to be subjective, to try and see the world as it really is, to harness facts about the world and build an accurate knowledge schema, in truth, our experiences are subjective. We view and extrapolate the world through an imaginative lens. We build the world in our own form, and in so doing, can massively miss what is actually there, as you could so easily see from that first clip from the Guardian News. But why is this? Well, it's because we're using our imagination system, memory, what psychologists term episodic cognition. It's about projecting the self in time. And in doing so, of course, we don't only question our memories, but we also question our identity, both individually and collectively. Indeed, it's been said that our memories are the door to identity. It's our memories that shape who we are. And of course, by implication, it's also who we are that shapes how we lay down new memories. And that's why you can think of perspective taking as being the key, both within ourselves and, of course, the groups to which we belong.
He dusts his shoulder as he watches his reflection closely and wonders which one is the real him, the one he feels himself to be within his core, or the one that can be seen from the outside in the glass, providing proof of his presence and identity. For mannequin, this is a particularly interesting question. The I he feels himself to be is in this moment the real he. The one in the mirror might not be him at all. It could even be a usurper of his position in the universe. He isn't sure. But rather than blame, be offended by the beautiful reflection, he had a strange sympathy for it and is prepared to tolerate its existence. He doesn't know who it is. Was it the person at the formal dinner early the previous evening, or the man later that he remembers walking the streets? Surely it is the weightless man who had such fun dancing tango after that. Or perhaps he is only the person he sees in this moment of self-reflection. He tries to anticipate what he will think next. Where is he going with all this? As he looks, he is confused, hardly realizing the extent to which he is staring with an intense, penetrating scrutiny. The time passing is an eternity for all he knows. the intoxicating concentration fractures and begins to splinter as he becomes distractedly aware of other figures. Two strangers come into his newly refocusing and expanding consciousness, appearing at the edges of his deteriorating fixed gaze. They are the reflection of a couple passing on the far side of the street behind him. They are wearing light-coloured outfits that show noticeably in the mirrored glass. The two young men are wearing pointed hats. They walk arm in arm, leaning in towards each other. They appear to be moving anonymously along the street. Maybe they are tired, sluggish, and like him, intent on returning home after their night's revelry. This world has me in it, with these people also. And the reflection has this other me in it, with these people reflected too, or are they different? My reflection is so easy to imagine as another me, one I don't fully recognize and whose presence I keep questioning. Yet, the reflection of the couple behind me, I imagine being the same people, but merely repeated in the window. How can my observation of self more easily confuse me than my observation of other persons? It is as if my life exists on a stage, like the one in this opera house, perhaps. As if my life can be viewed from a seat in the splendid auditorium simultaneously.
Cognitive neuroscientists argue that the primary function of memory is not to serve as a repository of the past, as we mentioned at the outset, but rather to support our ability to conjecture about what the future may hold, and in so doing it allows us to anticipate a number of alternative scenarios. After all, the future is by definition never certain, and in most cases an imagined future then is of course going to be a recombination of what we know about elements experienced from the past. But we introduce new elements, just as we do when we revisit and recreate our memories, very much aware that time alters the way in which we evaluate these thoughts.
Of course, this particular process is very good for creative thinking. It allows us so many options and allows us to move our thoughts seamlessly between the past, the present, and the future to engage in many time cards. It allows us to reflect on our thoughts and those of others, enabling us to juggle multiple perspectives involving other selves, time, and other times, and we can do this all simultaneously in mind's eye.
Of course, this has unique advantages when it comes to problem solving, because it allows us to invent new spaces, new times, and the ability to think outside the box. So, we as a species have the capacity to invent different systems for analysis, and we can change the parameters at will, employing both convergent and divergent thought processes. I suppose you can think of it as saying, well, which end of the telescope do we need to use when we've got the instrument up to our eye to think about what needs to be done next?
In this expert, you'll notice that it becomes difficult to work out whether in the present or the past or the future tense. Indeed, the whole process of reflection recorded here at the level human beings can do it to a remarkable extent. So try and watch this and notice how time shimmers in a number of different directions as you hear me read this. It is mid-afternoon on another imagined day. Caruso Maelstrom stands on the steel deck, his familiar boyish gaze passing over the paint-splattered chipped railing of the P&O passenger ferry. The far distant islands appearing as miniature outcrops of blue amidst the vast, cold, glistening, shimmering sea. Passing waves might roll and undulate. Airborne surf pound hard against the ship's prow, delivering the smell of salt water and sea into this beautiful man's flaring open nostrils. He senses, from what he sees, that the ocean's surface is only marginally warmer than what lays beneath. in some other realm beyond. As he looks, sunshine and the crystal daylight radiate out across the oceanic vista, throwing the various hard territories and islands into degrees of relief, the prevailing detail determined by his proximity to their majesty and magnitude. The nearest island, green-topped and brown-faced, with igneous rock weathered over millennia, is known to be the nesting place for seabirds. Guillemots are there, flying still, slicing through three dimensions, gliding over the formidable and available rocky landmass. Listen, the sound of their remote cries and calls can be heard even now, passing silently through the air and travelling on discreet, secret, transient breezes. The noise only briefly, temporarily deadened by miscellaneous activity that has, in truth, happened since within the animal annals of human memory. All of this occurred within space and time and has become no more than a remote symphony. That clouds, light, and beauty exist within his consciousness in this reimagined moment is a reality recognized to be too brief, ephemeral, and so easily lost. All this can only be remembered as belonging to a once known and impenetrably mislaid place, if it is remembered at all. Prompted by such airy thoughts, the man imagines and inwardly glimpses a breathtaking void stretching out before him into an unknown and impossible distance.
So one of the constraints of the imagination system of our subjective memory system is our obsession with the self in the present moment. And it's been described as a form of temporal myopia. And in his book, Stumbling on Happiness, Dan Gilbert reports a number of studies showing that our current desires influence our choices of not only what we want now, but of what we think we will want in the future. And here's one example from our own research. It concerns the planning of meal choices by humans. And what we did was we allowed people to eat as much chocolate or citrus foods as they would like. And before they were given this feeding opportunity, they were asked beforehand and afterwards to rank their choices of how much they thought they would enjoy eating these foods. And what we were interested in is, first of all, confirming that specific satiety had occurred. Now, specific satiety is a standard thing that having eaten a particular food until you're safe, that kind of satiety is specific to the food you've just eaten. So if you've just eaten lots of chocolate, you'll actually devalue the amount you want of chocolate and increase the value you'll want of citrus foods. And similarly, if you've just eaten lots of citrus foods, you should eat instead. And of course, what we're really interested in is whether that has any effect on future choices, because it shouldn't have. If you're entirely thinking about what you want in the future, whether you're sated on chocolate right now shouldn't really matter. You won't be at that time in the future. So what we found is that our specific satiety manipulation worked. So sure enough, when choosing food for right now, people are significantly affected by their current motivational state. As you can see here, this is the contrast of the ranking scores before and after they've been sated, either on chocolate or on citrus. And what you see is that if people eat a lot of chocolate, they increase their choices of citrus and refreshing foods. And when people have just eaten a lot of the citrus, they did in reverse, they decrease their choices of refreshing foods in favour of chocolate. So our specific manipulation works. Now what we're really interested in is whether that has any effect on the choices of what they want tomorrow. Because the motivational states induced by eating chocolate or citrusy foods shouldn't affect the choices of what you want tomorrow. By then, these effects will worn off. But they do. What we found is that people are significantly more likely to choose refreshing foods for tomorrow if they've just eaten a lot of chocolate and if they've just eaten a lot of the citrus fruits and dice person. So here we're showing an overinflation of the current motivational state.
There are, however, animals that don't make these kinds of mistakes. And these studies with James have shown this, that these birds cash for what they're going to want at some future date when they recover their stashes, unbiased by their current emotional states, unbiased by what they want now. And we can assess this evidence.
So here you can see the basic paradigm. These birds cash for hard food, as Clive said. You can see this very easily in the laboratory by having these little ice cream trays filled with a substrate that we can bury the food in, and we can have them cash in different trays on different days, and the trays in the which by these little bits of Lego Duplo that are attached around the sides of the cake. So what we can do, these diagrams represent the ice cream tray, which we can let them decide or cash two types of food, called an A and B for simplicity, and then recover them at a later date. And we can pre-feed them one of the two foods, so chocolate versus citrus food, for example, which in this case I'm logically just calling A and B, and half the animals are pre-fed A and half the animals are pre-fed B, but for simplicity I'm just showing you the case when they're pre-fed A. Now of course the prediction here is that just like people, if specific satiety is working, then if they've just eaten lots of A, they're going to want to eat and cash B. So the prediction is that in this case, the bird should continue eating and cashing the non-pre-fed food type, which in this case, illustrated here, is B. And we call this the same group to mean that they're pre-fed the same food prior to cashing as they are prior to recovery. But the interesting condition is what happens if you switch the foods. So you pre-feed them A before cashing and B before recovering. And of course it's counterbalanced, so for the other half of the animals they get B before cashing and A before recovering. Again, for simplicity, just showing you the first version of that. Now if these animals are stuck in the moment and they're biased by what the current self needs, just as we showed you in the previous menu choices studies of humans, then these birds should do exactly the same as the same group. Having been pre-fed on A, it's B they want, so they should continue eating and cashing the non-pre-fed B. But if they can learn that actually, when they come to recover, having been pre-fed B, it's A they're going to want. So if they can actually think about a future motivation state, maybe what they want at the time of recovery, opposed to what they want right now, then although they should continue eating B, because that is what they want right now, they should actually switch to cashing the pre-fed food type A, the food they don't want now, but they will want when they come to recover. And that's precisely what we saw birds do. Those in the same group switch to consuming the pre-fed food type because that's the food they want at the time of recovery. And it's not a switch in general preference for the two foods, because the same group and the different group continue consuming at the time of cashing, in other words, eating the non-pre-fed food.
The interesting question, of course, is why don't birds make these mistakes?
Well, although they remember and plan for the future, of course it's possible that they're using a different system from the one we normally use. After all, we've all experienced this kind of finding that you saw in the menu choices experiment. If you've ever tried going to do grocery shopping, for example, when you're really hungry, the amount of junk items that appear in the shopping trolley. Now you can overcome it by thinking logically about it, by using the knowing system and semantic system. If you think beforehand and write a shopping list, you can do it. But if you just nip to the shops on your way home and follow your intuitive episodic memory system, or imagination system, that's when we make mistakes. So in other words, it could be that using this more logical, more rational based system is actually easier in a sense to make the sort of logical decision for future self is by allowing one to take self out of the equation.
So of course, I suppose we can do this same thing as well. If we make a conscious effort to do it, that's what you're just saying. And we can even use it to our advantage within society. Society is increasingly motivated by cues that we follow fairly mindlessly without thinking about them too much. And we can turn temporal myopia to our own advantage, and we do it in a number of ways. Here's one example. We have improved our airports dramatically. We get off a long haul flight and we travel to the baggage depot area, and we find that our luggage is always there these days when we arrive. So we don't have to wait for our luggage very long at all these days. And that's simply because somebody had a clever idea of making us walk 20 minutes after we put up the airplane to the baggage hall, so that we get some circulation going around our bodies and all that kind of stuff. We improve our blood condition, no doubt. But that walk fills in the dead time which would make us anxious in any other way. So airports across the planet are doing this all the time. They're choosing to make sure the baggage claim area is a long way from where they're flying. That's a clever, clever technique. And we should watch out for these things because they're appearing all over the place in our society. Another way we might turn temporal myopia to our advantage is when we're waiting for a lift. Nicky has a penthouse in Manhattan, in actual fact, and I go and see her sometimes. At the concourse, I widen in the building on floor two, and I have to wait for a long time for the lift to come down. But I don't really mind it too much, because even though lifts are quite fast in Manhattan, I'm waiting on the outside, preening myself in the mirror, because the outside of the lift has a mirror. I'm getting myself ready for the big event. And sometimes the lift even goes down to the ground floor, and I don't mind too much, because I'm there watching the mirror. But actually, the lift doors are eventually open, and the long way, long journey to the top is no problem for me at all, because I just watch myself disappearing into infinity, because the inside of the lifts are also covered in mirrors. So we can find clever ways of dealing with the situation that we commonly find ourselves in. So these things work because our sense of time is relative, it's not absolute, and it capitalizes on our ability to do perspective taking. In short, our ability to project the self in time, to remember the past and imagine the future, is a subjective thing. It's not objective. And that's why it's possible to think about these things in actual fact as being illusory, as being illusory perception.
The same can be said of seeing. And there are a number of optical illusions, and of course the most famous one is the and of course it's interesting because although you've seen it before and although you know that the two lines are in fact the same length, nonetheless you see the bottom one is longer than the former because of the arrowheads you can see here. And of course what these kinds of optical illusions do is that they force the brain to believe that a phenomenon that it thinks it knows with utter certainty could be wrong. Or alternatively, it affords us the impression that we have the ability to see more than one alternative at virtually the same instant. Although not quite simultaneously, most of us will see the duck and the hare that enter the Cognition as flip-flopping between the two, to the point where we're no longer sure where the establishing point of reference is, and thus whether it's even appropriate to view these alternatives as dichotomy. So all of these visual effects serve to illustrate that there can be an association between what we see and what we know, or at least what we think we see and what we think we know. So these illusions are not interesting because they cause everyone to make a mistake. They're interesting because they cause every one of us to make precisely the same mistake. So the fact that we all make the same error suggests that these illusions actually reveal universal and significant features of the human mind.
As part of the experiment, completely scientific. Playing cards. Mattia, would you help out? Would you just take any card you like from the background? I suppose you all thought this was going to, thought it was going to be this kind of show. Could you sign the name on the face of the card? This would be the face, all right? So, Sophia's card, four diamonds, so that we know what's going on. She takes the playing card, and simply, probably in two directions, so the object of the exercise is that it should be a little bit smaller than it was. If I take the card like this, you can see that I'm now torn. Take a playing card at a minute before she goes. And I'm going to put those two in my pocket just for a second. I'm just going to work with these two pieces. Four diamonds. Is it quarters? Four is a quarter. Okay. So this is a one. These are two diamonds. Two diamonds. Which represents half the count. Now constitute three diamonds. I'm not mistaken. Normally when I don't get a diamond recorded at the first point, I usually get a second point, but not today. You guys all scientists, so I think the last one. So this will reconstitute Sophia's card totally. And indeed, Sophia, would you check out your signature? Thank you very much. So, did you notice the mismatch between your vision and your perception of the event that just occurred? In other words, the cognitive dissonance between seeing and knowing.
And of course, the most famous example of a cognitive dissonance that we come across in psychology is the shrew effect, where you're asked to say colour, not the word, and it's very tempting to say purple if you're only the first one, which is supposed to say colour. And the same kind of cognitive constraint is also experienced when we
recall the past. That's why the phrase that we used at the very beginning is so poignant. You might not remember it. In fact, you probably don't remember what happened. What you remember becomes what happened. Very clever sentence. You don't remember what happened. What you remember becomes what happened. It could be argued that you don't see all that happened because you're too busy fit into your previous schema based on your knowledge of how the world should unfold normally, it's being fair to you.
So the errors, the delusions induced in our perceptions are of course lawful, regular, and systematic. And they're not silly mistakes, they're clever mistakes, because given how systematic they are across our species, they actually allow those of us who understand them to glimpse the elegant design and inner workings of our visual and cognitive processes. As I said at the beginning, what we're interested in is the constraints on cognition and perception. This is why. And of course, the mistakes we make when we try to imagine our personal futures and reflect on our memories are also lawful, regular, and systematic. And they too have a pattern that tells us about the powers and the limitations of using our imagination system of our episodic cognition.
We want to show you a map of a planet that doesn't exist. It's a new world and not one that we recognise until until you have a chance to assimilate the information. There's a second one as well. The good thing about this map, if you see it close up, is that it's all written the right way around. Because the language is the right way around and the map's upside down, it does cause a moment of dissociation where you wonder what's going on. Some people find aspects of this kind of illusion more difficult than others. And I think these kind of examples illustrate some of the limitations of deception that we are interested in. We're conditioned by what we expect to see, whether it be optically, cognitively, or even emotionally.
We use our eyes to look into space. And we use our imaginations, our episodic cognition, to look into time. And just as our eyes sometimes lead us to seeing things as they're not, our imaginations lead us to remember things falsely and see things as they will not actually be.
These two things can be interlinked in interesting ways. Allow us to share with you a couple of examples.
Have any of you heard of the case of Jimmy G that Oliver Sacks describes in his wonderful book, The Man Who Is Like the Hat? Are you all familiar with that? Some of you? So the remarkable thing was that as a result of severe memory loss, Jimmy G was stuck in the past. So he was a man in his late 50s. At the time of the interview, who constantly relived his teenage years as a Marine with such intensity that he genuinely believed he was still 19. And in the powerful scene that Oliver Sacks describes, he really imagined the grief that he felt when he looked into that hateful mirror and saw a white-haired, mature man staring back at him, a man who shared so many features with him. Clearly it was the same man, and yet so was his age. How could this really be?
The second thing I'd like to share with you is the notion of boundary extension. This is a phenomenon whereby people consistently perceive and imagine a greater expanse of the scene than the one that they were actually shown. And we can see this in the kind of slides that we're looking at right now. It could be that this is an experiment, which is the first image that we've shown, which flashed up in front of you for a few seconds and was taken away. And then you'll give a choice of four different images, all of them very, very simple. Time and time again, people don't actually manage to identify the picture that they first saw. They generally go for some image that shows more of the image, the original image, than they really saw. It's as if people are imagining they can see around corners. A bit like that famous film Playground, when Decker took a photograph and puts on his computer, goes into the photograph, even goes around corners, and finds out what's in the bathroom. So we might see this image, but recollect that one. It's been done in very, very interesting ways. I, for example, spent most of my time being a fine art painter during my lifetime. And when I first did this experiment, I thought, I'm too good for this. But I was caught out every time. Because I want to interpret what I'm seeing. I want to see further. I want to know what's going on. And so I can't help myself but create the illusion of knowing more about the thing than is really there. I'm probably making it up. I'm conjecturing in interesting ways. I'm seeing more than is really there. And even when you get other people to draw what they saw, they show more. They show more. Some commentators have said, well, yes, these people can't draw that, can they? They can't look at composition properly, you can't see things accurately. But believe me, even if you have somebody who is very competent and looks at the phenomenology of drawing, they would actually find to include more. Now the interesting thing about all of this is that amnesiacs, like Jimmy G, don't suffer from boundary extension at all. You give them this same test, and they're not fooled by the experiment at all. They will actually, on a regular basis, identify the original image that they saw.
And what Eleanor Maguire's work has shown is that this is because they're unable to mentally construct or reconstruct scenes. We, on the other hand, use our imaginations, our episodic cognition, to amend and abet what we selectively see and remember. And these are fundamental features of the mind and a consequence of the illusory nature of perception and memory.
If such fundamental features as perception and memory can be inconsistent, then so too can be consciousness. Conscious awareness arises out of our belief in the substance and the reality of the external world, and our recognition that we are integral and a part of it. It is the facility that allows us to question realities and monitor our perceptions and memories, no doubt, senses. It's the very fact that consciousness is an emotion that allows us to be aware of the illusory nature of perception and memory.
So it's perhaps our ability to see, to remember, to imagine futures, and importantly to plan alternative scenarios concerning who we are or might become, concerning places and times that in truth may never have existed except in our imaginations, that lies at the heart of our creativity, our problem solving, and our humanity. Thank you.